So I think we're going to pass the stage to Dr. Kirchheim. Thank you.
Okay, now it's time for the first our first invited speaker, Professor Yoshinori Sakisaka. Okay, let me explain a little bit about Professor Yoshinori Sakisaka. He is a professor in the Applied Mathematics Department, Global Information and Telecommunication Institute, and Language and Speech Science Research Lab, Waseda University. He's a professor that working in the speech and language science and engineering in the field more than 40 years. And during this period, he worked at NTT, Electrical Communication Research Lab, ATR, Edinburgh University, AT&T Bell Labs, Kobe University, NICT, and so on. He also interested in speech synthesis, prosody modeling, speech recognition, speech perception and language processing, and engaged in a lot of international research activity, including IEEE Signal Processing Society committee member, Speech Communication Journal Editorial Board, and France Telecom CNET, and so on. And he also initiated ESOP or Asian Language Speech Corpus Project Research. We promote research on Asian language studies and collaboration among Asian countries. I met a professor for more than 10 years, and he's joined in SNLP since 2003 for more than 40 years. And he participated every time after that. And now I'd like to invite Professor Yoshinori Sakisaka to give a talk in this time. Okay. Please welcome, Professor.
Can you hear me? Okay. Sarika. It's really my pleasure and feel very honored to have an opportunity to present our work here at ISAI MIT. As Dr. Tetre introduced me, I'm attending SNLP from 2003, which is held in here. Are there any persons who attended 203 SNLP meeting?
203.
And after that, I noticed that at 205, it was held in Chennai. And are there any people who attended that SNLP meeting in Chennai?
Only you.
And I noticed that I gave her invited talk here. And you see, from that time on, more than 10 years has passed. So as I wrote in my abstract, I tried to introduce two of our recent works. But the time scale in my recent work means that I've been working more than 40 years, almost half a century. So between the recent is two decades. And so I guess most of the people have not listened to my first tutorial talk. So I'll briefly sum up something in my talk. Anyway, all right, start. So this talk consists of two parts. The first one is the description and generation of communicative F0. And the purpose of this first talk is to have more advanced speech output, which is because most of you are familiar with TTS, text-to-speech, and all TTS systems make it possible to provide the speech in a dead tone. But as I first ask you, sounding back, right? You see, people are saying good morning, bonjour, waiozaimasu, in many languages in a very positive fashion. We don't say sounding back, right? There's a difference. This is quite important. The first talk is relating on that point, okay? The second one is the topic itself is totally apart from the first one. And the question like this, when I say, which car do you imagine? Okay, and how about O? Which car do you imagine? Kara. Okay, anyway, I'll answer to this question. And superficially, at least, they are totally independent. You may think it that way. But finally, I hope that you understand why they need to independent studies are related and how it works. Okay. So let's start from the first one. And for the first one, actually, I have presented quite a few presentations more than a decade. A part of them are listed here, mainly focusing on post-related meetings, conferences, and also SNP. So if you'd like to know the detail of something, please consult with your own legal SNP proceedings. And it's really a pleasure to have the opportunity to present some of the works, important works at SNP. And so let's start from the description and control for communicative speech. And first, as I mentioned, prosodic differences as made in a latest speaking style and the real communicative way. The difference between good morning, right? And so far people have started to use the robots or some human interface. In the world, now, this is no specific task who can output speech with bonjour, good morning. Instead, they simply say good morning, Ohio lines. It's not the human, right? And not only good morning, Saka is okay. You see, every speech has its way of saying, and people can share all things. Almost all language, we share the same kind of some feeling. Okay, so the feeling is a key of this matter. To synthesize a speech, like, I want to call this a communicative speech, not a led speech. Like, thank you very much. As you see some sign there, people put on something. In particular, Japanese young ladies and younger generation people put this kind of extra marks to show some good, some fun way. And we need some extra information of this mark, of course, specifics to add the communicative speech. I'm interested in neither in phonetics and phonology, nor speech signal processing. Not any researchers have never treated this kind of information. It's quite strange, okay? If speech, good morning is different. Of course, we can measure the difference in terms of speech parameters, but there's no science nor engineering treat these kind of things. And to make it possible, in particular to output speech, we need some input, extra input, to distinguish them. So what input we can think of, and how to control, those are totally unknown things. And even not having any particular lexical form, or lexical form of that, the speech like even simple people can convey some information, okay? And sometimes you say, this is nice. Really? I hope that you understand that you share the prosody of and expressions. Okay, so that's one key. So one of my friends, Campbell, who collected the data for daily females, every day, 3 months, from morning to night, and from that time, we extracted it's around 20,000, 30,000 something. And if you make some computational, you can find this kind of complex room, which has, this one has been just done out after our work, and which is nicely concerned with us. Okay, that's fine. My student Lieber started to analyze this in Germany communication debate and found that after this in, some special words are formed. And according to her analysis, this is the last sketch of her analysis verse, and according to her observations, fundamental frequency height, vocal code vibration difference, high and low, and all types of dynamics shown by different way of understanding. So, from this part, what we have decided is we use this F0 vocal code violation height, high, middle, low, and four dynamics, so which gives 12 different type of and using 12 different types of we asked the people there, and how you feel, please describe it through your impression. And we just gathered the work that they wrote. And finally, we got around 46, I'm sorry, 660 something descriptions. And among them, 26 descriptions are shared by multiple people. So we decided we would like to have a, you know, full description of them. We only, because of the description of experimental side, we decided to use 26 adjectives, many adjectives, to describe this nature. So we analyze these 12 different its height and dynamics, and ask the other listeners how you evaluate this in terms of these 26 dimensions. And in the field of psychology and computational psychology, there's some good way of reducing the dimension, actual dimension, or you can say the hidden dimension, to describe this. And finally, we applied mathematics, which is called MDS, multidimensional scaling, and applying the multidimensional scaling to this data. Luckily, we could find three dimensions, and I'll show some results how they work. In a dimension one and dimension two, the mapping is like this. Each arrow shows each one. Okay? It corresponds to some words which are used for our description. Okay. So, for example, the first blue arrows correspond to question, doubt, ambivalence. And so far, we need some name for that. My student just named it as a doubtful direction. On the other hand, the left-hand side is coincided with understanding of loop. And from the words that you can understand, it's almost opposite. Okay, so this is one dimension. The red one corresponds to ordering, bad moving, rushes. That's a negative one. Okay. On the other hand, the upper one corresponds to happy, good mood, excited. As you see, in this dimension one and dimension two, doubtful, confident, and positive, negative, axis could be found. Okay, so like this. and each dot corresponds to 12 species stimuli that we use for our perceptual experiment. And first, 4 is coincide with a high F0 samples. The middle one is corresponding to middle F0. And low one is corresponding to the and it's along with positive and negative. Okay. When you people say in a positive fashion, I okay. And you will not say I okay. And in particular, those, I think there's some Japanese ladies here, in Japan at least, when they speak in form, okay, you say that you raise the speech. How about in Thailand? They is a later speech. Anyway, we behave in a unconsciously control the F0 type. From the dynamics viewpoint, as you see in this circles, it's coincided with the mass coincided with the conflict in this way. So this is a dimension one and dimension two. And in dimension two and three, new factors, which is coincide with objection denied and agreement, could be found. And the red one is again the same negative and positive one. So in this dimension 2 and dimension 3, we have allowable, acceptable axis and negative positive axis. And each stimulus coincide with this kind of nicely arranged axis. So by assuming all things, we can really say in terms of its perception, we could say the dynamics is contributing to show doubtful, confident differences and acceptable, allowable, unacceptable, and allowable differences in terms of dynamic differences. And high low is showing some positive, negative traits. And so, in the case that we synthesize the mean without specifying which impression that mean has, it's hard to synthesize it. But when you have some linguistic form, like this is nice, okay, and we can guess how this person is, and clearly, people are doubting something from each person doing lessons. To think of what kind of impression these expressions may have as a default. Okay. So in quite recent SNMP, one of my students and presented one, which is the idea that we use the lexicon-driven communicative process explanation. And in early TTS system, we first analyze input sentences and try to find us some accentuation information or some phrasal relationship, and using that we make a prosody. But for our case, in the communicative speech synthesis, we add on some communicative control part, which is from the constituting response, we can refer to the dictionary and get some information. Scientists, attributes, and using that attribute, we add on some communicative prosody model. For the communicative prosody model, we can create the calculation in this way. I don't know how you say it in Thailand, but it is really beautiful in Japanese. So and the first code, this has no particular impression, but the DNA and that beautiful and question mark gives you some sort of communicative functions. So using these values, you can calculate three dimensions that I showed you for the analysis, you just calculate it, the lambda, and just plug into the control. For that process control, we employ the converse force model. Sometimes we do the parallel set model. And this one of the beauty of this model is very small numbers and you can control the process. Okay. So in particular in this as you see in this figure, the phasor component magnitude AP and accent component magnitude AA and the lower additional portion FB. Three parameters are only needed to provide the whole shape. Because other portions are almost constant. So applying this model to that one, and we simply calculate the umbrella F0 using the lead F0 parameters. And using the neural network trainer, we get the umbrella zero generation. And finally, we can get this kind of soto kire kana, eko kire da, this kind of thing. As you see, the relatively good match could be seen between the observed F0 frequency and the calculated frequency. Okay, so the first bug is on the process generation. And second one, as I first mentioned, you may think it's totally independent. And anyway, first of all, this I'm going to describe the second topics, and then I'll try to unite them together. Concerning to the second talk, and which is the secondary accessory description of speech like there's a In this kind of multimedia interactions, there are quite a few bugs have been carried out, not in the language or speech area, but in a much more human science things. And as you look back at the work that I have just presented, I used 26 words to show the differences. And if you carefully think about what these 26 words are corresponding to, you can classify roughly in three groups: doubtful, comprehensive, and acceptable, allowable, negative, positive, as I just showed you, as a result of multimedia scaling. But you see, what has it? The reason that we are trying to carry out this kind of combination is because of the constraint of language, I should say. Because more or less people here are biased by the language or linguistics and speech or speech engineering. And we do not care about outside in your car. So I'm the person who speech, so I've never thought about other fields. But if you will think about how the speech and language works, we notice the speech and car description, we are suffering the same problem, and which is, as I've just presented, we can use a linguistic impression. Of how you describe those things and can quantify them using some scaling. But if you seriously thinking about the daily work, daily conversations, some problems are existing using language form. As you see, lead. There's so many lead, so people specify some like a LED. And green, again, you know, green, blue, maybe blue, you know, so many different tools. But so far, the language is the only tool that we describe their natures. That's inevitable for us to do this kind of discussions. And we think, can think of to be free from this kind of language limitation. Because language limitation means that we only have a discrete number of them and a very limited size. We have to express its nature. So I thought that some mapping between speech and characters is much more flexible and free. So why not take care of these things? And as I mentioned, in this kind of sensory analysis has been carried out in many different fields. And right to the, because I don't think that so many people know about these kind of activities, I would like to introduce some of them. The first one is a progression between images and words. One of the famous work, probably some of you may know the first work, which is Luba-Kiki effect, presented by Terra in the old day. So he asked to their subjects to identify which is Buba, which is Kiki. So he's showing these two figures and asked the subject for the right hand side, okay, the star shaped one. What do you think? Which do you select, Buba or Kiki? Could you raise your hand who thinks Buba is pointing to the right hand side one? Raise your hand high. I'm sorry, the left hand side one. Okay. The left hand, the star shaped one. That's Kiki. Could you raise your hand? Okay. So most people will raise the left hand side as the shaped one as Kiki. And the right hand side as okay. This is the work. And superficially, the whole work is completely independent. But later, please try to think of how they work. And one of my old student, Fujino, who is a 3, he can 100 meters in less than 11 minutes, say 11 seconds, and work together with many sports people, and in particular in this picture, they are making some teaching kit for judo players. And Osei Inoue is a subject, he is a good friend of him, and showing the judo tsukuri kuzushi and kake in this picture, and using some speech.
Sa.
And if you describe this, simply this sa, right? But they are different. And according to their theory in judo playing, some bad are playing the shows very bad speech, and some shows a very good speech. So it's hard for us to understand what the difference is. Of course, we can acoustically analyze the differences. But what we need, after we understand what's happening, then we have to let the learners understand. How about your son, right? So we need some description of them. Yours is like this. In a parametric way, gives you something, but not in a fashion. Okay. A second one is the correlation between sound and color. And non-verbal mapping has been studied by Nagata. And according to her work, she just showed some sound. And there are some people once you listen to some sound, they see some colors. Are there any people who has this special capability, which is called synesthesia? No. Those are the people who have this capability. Once you listen to something, then color pop up. And so she tried to compare this special, the people who have special capability and all people, and using a sound screener and consisting of many different tones and also different ear tones and various types of mix and height. Ask the listeners to describe the select the color that they feel after listening to the speech. And for that selection, she used the PCC system. And PCC system is this kind of system. And as it's hard to describe what color it is, so with like a palette, she showed this and asked the listeners to select the monitor. And so by doing this, she found the similarities between the people who have some specific capability and ordinary people. And finally, if you move to the topics in our more close area, which is speech, and the color dimension from vowels have been already presented by this group. Actually, some old phoneticians have carried out the analysis since year from the group on speech science, but this person has carried out some experiment. So the task was asking select the sounds after listening to some vowel sounds. And in their cases, they're using English vowels and applied to some European students to select the English. English is not their native language, but select any color that they feel from their speech they listen. And as a result, if you summarize all things, from vowel D, mostly corrected the yellow color, and A as green, and blue, brown, blue, black. It's very scattered in many ways, but the tendency is quite alike. And also R is red. And finally, that is our work. And Watanabe has carried out this experiment. And what she did was, after listening to all the sounds, she imaged color category was selected, and speech stimuli as stimuli. We used the same stimuli that we used for the analysis, and which means that three height for dynamics of five vowels. This time we use five vowels. So around 60 speech stimuli, we asked randomly show the subject and select the color using the same assess that we have already used PC by showing some Japanese vowels and the select one of this car. And you see, in the previous work, people as a politician have done this kind of thing. They want to correlate between vowels categories and character categories. At that time, when I listened to this talk, 208, because I attended this workshop, And I hope, why don't you just try to calculate them much more speech-related parameters to color-related parameters. Because for speech parameters, we can have many, right? And for colors, as you know, like RGB, red, green, blue, you can decompose each color into three dimensions. It's so from the computational view, it's much more. You make a direct comparison. And my student, Watanabe, has carried out this experiment. And in her case, she used not the RGB, but HSV. And those who are familiar with the psychology of color, HSV coordinate is much more suited to express the same things rather than an RGB. There's some one-to-one correspondences between RGB and HSV. Hue value saturation. And interesting enough, she could have found a very, very strong correlation between speech and color. And the first correlation is the correlation between complementary frequency and value, the brightness. As you see in this picture, the correlation is more than 0.91. This is the highest correlation I've encountered in my research life. And it's amazing. For elderly streamer REUA, Japanese for hours, the F0 difference is nicely mapped to the values. And second correlation could be found between sound pressure level power and saturation value. And as you see, the correlation is again quite high, 0.85 for each power. And it's amazing the power is nicely correlated to saturation. And so, value and saturation, there are three, the third factor. There's a hue. The hue is a little bit hard to read. It's hard to describe because it's hard to describe in terms of the parameters. So we just go back to the color categories and power categories for you to understand how the spectrum hue are related. And as you see, this is a selected results of hours of some experiment. And as you see, for each REUAO, the distribution is quite low, which means that not only just one color, but also other colors have been selected and for each bar. But if you carefully look at those distributions, there's some concentrations. And apparently, this concentration could be observed not only our experiment, but also the experiment as shown the other people. And also, 2 years ago in ICPHS Glasgow, the Chinese people are showing the same characteristics. And their characteristics almost alike. So, from the viewpoint of there are some statistical properties, they are quite nicely correlated. And if you make some calculation of their correlation, it's more than 0.8. So again, it's highly correlated. And if you plot this in terms of first formant frequency and second formant frequency, which correspond to the resonance frequency of speech, for vowels, and which is nicely coincide with your mouse figures, in particular the jaw opening and closeness, and the tongue front back can be represented in this first and second format, as you see in the picture, and which is nicely coincide with the distribution of cards. And if you write it down in terms of the time position and Java opening, it can roughly say the correspondence is like this. And E is a sort of yellow and R is orange. And you see when you say R to E, right? The color is again, it's between R and E, the A sound you make here, I, right? A is here. And the same way that we interpolate the red and the yellow, the green portion could be observed like this one. So it's nicely coincided with these things. And in this lecture, I did not prepare particular PowerPoints, but one about another student who is still a graduate found that these progressions nicely could be observed in terms of the first form and second form, not others, neither third, one, not three, third, and fourth, but only first or second, and the values are no progression. So it's nicely correlated to the acoustic signal property of that. Okay, so in assuming the result that we have just presented, the high correlation could be found between F0 and W, some pressure level of saturation, and Q is almost the same as we have seen. Other examples. And currently we are keep going on this kind of association using another speech features. And in particular for this case, we want to ask the listeners to make a choice of pictures by listening same app, but different force, as excitation. These three motor tricky medium as one of the very difficult speech differences and speech production people have carried a bunch of analysis on them. And we made a mapping between the speech source parameters to the texture parameters. And for such source parameters, you can calculate some sort of source code spectra, in particular the first harmonics and the second harmonics ratio. And for texture parameters, from each pixels, we calculate some image-driven parameters. And in the field of image, there's work on how to associate with that impression using the linguistic form. And there's some already existing database which nicely classify the textures in terms of the linguistic property of that. So we adopted that data and make a correlation analysis on these kind of things. This is exactly what that we presented last week in Stockholm. And if you're interested in this work, just consult with that presentation. Okay. So, first of all, I'd like to conclude my talk. I just presented two of our studies, and experimental studies. First one is correlated to cognitive prosody, how we control. And for that control, the crucial point is how you describe it, okay? For that description, we use the semantic difference pairs with scores, not the success of our analysis, and we can finally generate the cognitive speech using that information. And second one is, again, the description of speech by other media, which is image, color, and textures. And as first mentioned, these two topics are totally independent. But if you think about this kind of different studies, from the viewpoint of media differences, we notice we are constrained. Okay, the more that you study in some specific area, in particular in this area, people are working in either AI or language or speech. And so we are not so much constrained on that one. Many of you may think the image or other thing is out of our field. But from the viewpoint of description, that's quite alike. And I don't know how many people have a strong background in linguistics. But if you look at the history of linguistics, in old days, linguistics is embedded in the study of human. From that, sometime now, some sort of structuralism has started. Linguistics is apart from human studies from that on. And now have a wonderful, maybe analysis of result from that on. But at the same time, we are losing something which is strongly linked to human beings. So the message I would like to say is
yes, yeah, it's really interesting that you post about the sound or the phonetic information that can give us some sense or some mood, some life mood. I'm not sure that if you like in I also feel the same feeling that sometimes we can understand their feeling from even we don't know what they talk, but we know the mood of the talking. That's okay. But I'm not sure that there is for the mood or the level of the sound can express sometimes have a common component, but sometimes have a different component. For example, in China, I see a lot of Chinese people coming to China. But when we talk, we look like they fighting each other. But they just only talk with each other. But when you feel like they do something really, yeah, fight with each other, something like that. And also that is another one. Another part of the mood. The mood that we feel different from them. So I'm not sure, sometimes we have the common part, sometimes we have different. And I have to have some idea on that point. But you said about the mood, maybe similar among the nation. And the language,
mood
or the sound you express, this is the bad mood, this is sad mood, something.
And you know, it's really the problem because you're working in the language processing. Like a translation is really a hectic problem, right? And we use something similar corresponding notions and use that as a translation word or something, and then you just describe as mood, right?
Yeah.
And even in my presentation, I was wondering which one is suitable for this presentation. And if there are English natives, you may say this segment nurse is not good.
Yeah.
Actually, some people say, I sometimes use sensory information or something, but again, in some people who are serious working in these topics, so it's a kansei information. Kansei jōbō is a Japanese term for that, and they are slightly different from this consentment information. So, because some portion that includes their already existing studies, like about the quality or speech quality type of things. So, people who have a strong background in phonetics or phonology may say there's a part of from the speech quality or something, but I don't want to use these already existing terms because, as I first mentioned, once you deepen your studies, you're constrained in some way. So speak, when I was invited in some other phonetic related conferences, I sometimes dare to say in a very bad phrase, because many phoneticians are constrained by written language, even though they are studying spoken language. Okay, because the linguistic form itself is one of the big targets of those studies. People rushing to understanding this kind of thing. still there are existing difficult problems, and we are still tackling on that. But what I would like to say here is there are other parts. For example, thinking about speech recognition, people more or less have succeeded to recognize something, even the spontaneous speech, to some amount people have already could have an analyzed. And definitely for NLP, you're extracting some kind of feeling from the tendencies, either this is for or against, right? This kind of simple extraction have you already carried out. But once you're sticking to the language by itself, in particular for the work working in NLP, speech by itself, working in the speech here, that's not enough. That's my message.
Yes. So you look at the paralinguistic information.
Yes, exactly.
But if you like, sometimes different countries have different paralinguistics.
Okay, wait, let me say something. Thank you for using the term paralinguistics. Okay. Because in the phonetics of phonology, if you read the classical book of phonetics phonology, then people say this is definitely the paralinguistic issues. So they first avoid from their analysis. And para means out, okay? Para, so we know is out. But what I'd like to say here is we should not treat as a para, rather than we have to include. So I would like to prefer to use the term panlinguistics. Okay. Of course, you know, some panlinguistics term is have already been used for some purposes. Actually, Professor Nagao's point, when I was trying to use this word for other things, he mentioned that he has the language people have already used something, but it's still constraining language or little language things. I prefer to have much more, you know, go back to the original study of human beings. And once you more clearly understand what it is, because the language itself can be regarded as one tool to describe everything and to formulate everything to make a better analysis and science and technology, okay? But if you're constrained on that, there's limitation. And for example, thinking about semantics, language people think about semantics, but in terms of the linguistic form only. But for example, if you, as you just described, the way that we analyze, and if you compare the speech, とってもきれい、すごくきれい、まあまあできれい. You see, F0 is this, somehow reflected that meaning. So we can quantify it using the speech. So like this way, like say, computing semantics, people have never carried out this kind of, you know, quantification of the semantics in the field, but so far, I think I'm quite sure that people and working in NLP will proceed in the understanding of the is one of the really serious goal in future. And to do that, I think some links between the or some knowledge grounding of people is one of the really tough problem. And these kind of words, I hope that you will understand as a, just a pilot study, in a very, very small study towards that direction.
Thank you so much for really interesting talk. Again, when we have a particular talk, I feel that it inspired me to think about something more. About the issues of possibility of zero features. Do you think that this is common for all languages, as far as you know? How can we extract this kind of phenomena to, I think we like to embed this kind of information into the text or the communication. So if we know that the common among the languages, so maybe quite useful. And the second question is that you show three dimensions to show the people intention in the talk, acceptance or confidence or doubtful. Do you think that these three axes or three dimensions will be the fear in terms of like sarcasm I don't have intention about different intention, but I show some expression about that. Can you please do some comments on this?
Okay, so thanks so much for nice questions. First one, first question is as the same as Dr. Turner just pointed out. You made all of you a sort of a social links issues. I agree there are strong social links issues. And one example that I showed you, the female speech, control unconsciously or consciously control the height, right? And when you, in particular Japanese ladies, when they meet the outside of their families, they raise their speech. And more or less this kind of phenomenon could be seen everybody, but at the same time, the quantity is quite different. So sociolinguistically, it should be more, precisely studied. But again, there are some tendencies that we have in common. Because thinking about this morning of Sari Club, we are not taught, we have to say Sari Club instead of Sari Club, right? Once you started to understand the morning, say good morning, and don't say good morning, okay? So that's the issue, okay? And so you may say this is a language universal fact in some way, and also some language specific one, if you want to classify language specific or language universal one. And concerning to the second question, again, that's actually where interest for the second question. And we are still looking for what kind of variabilities we may have. In the field of speech, people started to analyze so-called expressive speech or emotional speech, some people may say. But I'm totally frustrated about these kind of things because for each speech utterance that I am talking to you, I try to convey some of my intention for you to ask him to understand what I want to ask you to understand, okay? So that's very important. The people can feel it. The, in particular, females are much better than males. And in a very detailed thing, you can distinguish them, okay? So like the judo play, the reason that I showed you some judo play without sound, for us all it's almost the same. It's slightly different, but don't care. Some judo players really care who has a gold medalist is saying this is important, in particular in a practice to acquire that skill. So which means that so some specific people who has a quite strong sensitivity of that can listen to differences. Okay, that's an important issue. And earlier, someone engaged in this multi-media world, so less and less the language information goes important. And we are somehow lacking the capability and the sensitivity to handle them. So it's a sort of warning that we have to pay more attention to these kind of things more seriously and what the information. It may come the occasion that young people and our older generation cannot share the same feeling. It's the same, media. So in that way, I hope that we are now trying to more carefully about these kind of things. And actually, we have carried out another experiment by differentiating how the subjects are feeling in a different way, the same media.
Okay, thank you so much for Professor. Okay, and please give a big hand to you again for our